Today's session is titled Politics, Economics, and Religion, Small Topics. And what I'll do is introduce the speakers right before each of their talks. And if you don't mind holding your questions until the end of the four presentations, we'll be sure to have some time then to respond to all of your curiosities. So I want to begin by introducing Zhongji Wu, a history and economics double major, graduating senior. Title of her paper is Business Reform in Communist China, 1949 to 1978.
Awesome, thank you. Thank you everyone for being here. And today I will be presenting on my thesis in history. In the past year, I spent much time studying the business history of Communist China, or more specifically, the business reform that was unfolding in China at the enterprise level. The business history of China may sound familiar, as the rise of China has brought much attention to the country's market reform in 1978. The business history of Communist China, though, might not be as familiar as it sounds. By Communist China, I mean China during the radical socialist period, or more precisely, between the year 1949 and 1978. The year 1949 marked the founding of the People's Republic, and some of you might have known or even remembered the founding of the People's Republic on October 1st, 1949, when Chairman Mao stood in front of the Tiananmen Square and declared the independence of the country. The year 1978 marked the market reform of the country and the new era in the country's business history. The study of the business history of Communist China was surprisingly scarce and very rare. There has been, for example, extensive study on the business history of China prior to 1949, when the Nationalist Party was in power, as well as after 1978, when the miraculous economic growth of the country started to draw attention from the world. The curious period in between, which I introduced as the radical socialist period of the country, received very little attention from historians. This is because during the Maoist era, China was under a rigid, centrally planned economy. Individual factories were perceived as implementation units of the national plan, and therefore, there was nothing interesting to look at the enterprise level in terms of business or economic decision making. Yet, in my thesis, I argue that the business history of Communist China, in particular how the history unfolded at the enterprise level, is an extremely important subject of study that sheds light on the market reform in 1978. It is important because this is a period that immediately preceded the high economic growth that started to kick off in China in 78. I also argue that in reality, even during the Maoist era, important business decisions were made by individual factories. Through studying the business decision-making behavior at the enterprise level, I have come to the conclusion that the adoption market, the adoption market in 1978 was not driven by a sudden radical ideological commitment to market, but rather was an outgrowth of a series of problem-solving efforts that Chinese economic actors encountered as early as the 1950s, when China first started to industrialize. Let me introduce the core argument of my thesis in a slightly different way. One way, also the conventional way, to view the reforms in post-1978 years is to see them as part of a deeper ideological, political, and economic sea change of the post-Mao era, during which market became the new line, effectively replacing the dominant role of the central planning. In my argument, however, market reforms are the outgrowth of a series of efforts to tackle the problem of coordination encountered by Chinese enterprises that went all the way back to 1950s, almost three decades before the market reform. Let me now go back to the point that I previously made about business decision making at the enterprise level and elaborated on why individual factories were left alone to solve various bottlenecks they encountered. The task of centrally planning the economy of a country like China, given the size, the level of backwardness of the economy, and the limits of planning capacity was almost impossible. Local factories, for example, often received mandatory production orders from above, even though they had no means of fulfilling such targets. This was what the historian Carl Ruskin referred to as skeletal planning, which means that there was an overarching national plan in place, yet important business decisions were made at the enterprise level. The challenge of skeletal planning became increasingly hard to be overlooked during the Great Leap Forward, a massive movement that unfolded across the country between the year 1958 and 1961, aiming to industrialize the country at an unprecedented and unrealistic pace. Some of you might have associated this movement with the construction of tens of thousands of the so-called backyard steel furnaces, which integrated the process of iron making, iron refining, and steel making as a way to address the shortage of steel on the national scale. If you look at the propaganda material at the time, people were encouraged to bring steel and iron, pots and pans, and all the related products to send to these backyard steel furnaces. It was at that time, during the Great Leap Forward, that individual factories and production units were usually left alone to solve their own bottlenecks in production. Let me share with you an example of how a small-scale factory made its own business decision when it was trying to fulfill a planning target prescribed from above. This came from an article published in the Machine Building Weekly on January 31st, 1959. The article introduced the Jinyan Machinery Factory, which was a small-scale factory in Shanghai with only 70 workers in 1954. In 1959, during the Great Leap Forward, the factory was instructed from above to produce 7 sets of rolling mills. However, the Jinyan factory had no means to produce these relatively complicated and large-scale machinery because it lacked the necessary machine tools to do so. Nor could the planning apparatus meet the production needs of this particular local factory. Therefore, the factory turned to making its own machine tools in order to manufacture the rolling mills required. In the year 1959, it made a total of 63 such machine tools that were necessary to fulfill the planning target. The solution that the Jinyan factory came up with was not unique in China in the 1950s. In fact, this makeshift solution was turned into a virtue and was seen as a positive and much celebrated model to be followed by all Chinese enterprises. Some factories even began to make their own iron and steel. This model came to be known as a complete factory model, referring to enterprises that produced the necessary components or raw materials in-house. In an editorial that was published in the People's Daily in 1960, for example, the author cited a quotation from Chairman Mao advocating for the complete factory model, quote from the editorial. In September of 1958, while Chairman Mao was touring and conducting inspections in the Hubei province, he once said, quote, "For large enterprises such as the Wuhan Iron and Steel Corporation, in addition to producing steel and iron-related products, they can also expand into the machine building industry, chemical industry, construction industry." Now, a year later, the great vision of Chairman Mao has been realized. Factories such as the Wuhan Steel and Iron Corporation and Baotou Steel and Iron Company not only produced steel and iron, but also cement, refractory materials, and machinery, unquote from the editorial. Many outside observers criticized and even ridiculed the complete factory model, dismissing it as extremely inefficient, backward, and as ideological extreme of the Great Leap Forward. However, there was important business logic and rationale behind such a solution. The complete factory model arose as a specific response to the challenge faced by individual enterprises under skeletal central planning. Many Chinese economic actors thought that this was a workable solution, but not everyone agreed. In theory, economic analysts of communist China understood that specialization was superior to the complete factory model. With specialization, the benefits of the economy of scale could begin to unfold, bringing improved product quality, lower production costs, and greater variety in the products. The main barrier to specialization remained the challenge of coordination. In a socialist economy like China, how individual enterprises coordinated supply and demand might not be as straightforward as in a market economy. In a country like the United States, for example, market mechanisms took care of such coordination. This is what a market is meant to do. It encourages specialization, it allows for coordination, and it regulates the supply and demand of the economy. In China, however, factories that were not in the same production unit of a complete factory had great difficulty in achieving such coordination. Without a well-developed market and limited capacity of the national plan, producers were unable to meet specific needs from the users, and it was even more challenging for the users to acquire certain customized machine parts from the producers. Starting from the 1960s, a new movement began to unfold in China. In my thesis, I named this period the specialization and coordination movement, during which the complete factory model came under attack. In order to get around with the problem of coordination and improve the level of specialization in the economy, Chinese economic actors came up with a system of enterprise-level coordination that made use of the coordination conferences. These coordination conferences were organized by provincial, municipal, and local governments that sought to bring users and producers of certain products together. Local factories then would send representatives to these conferences so that they could communicate with each other and also sign contracts with each other on the spot. Effectively, coordination conferences promoted enterprise-level contractual coordination. Although they were called conferences, they were actually rudimentary form a marketplace for industrial producers at that time. In today's language, we would probably have called them fairs. The specialization and coordination movement unfolded between 1960 and 1965. And I made the argument that by mid-1960s, China was on the threshold of market coordination. This was more than a decade earlier than the market reform that took place in 1978. However, the movement came to an abrupt end when the Cultural Revolution began. During the Cultural Revolution, specialization and coordination were dismissed as capitalist practices and came under attack. But look at the propaganda. At the time, the chairman of the Chinese Communist Party, Liu Shaoqi, he was being attacked. You see the tiny little figure there. So he was at the time the representative of capitalist practices. However, with the fall of the Game of the Four and with the end of the Cultural Revolution, the reform era began. And this is the images that we often associate with the miraculous economic growth, the flourishing of Shanghai, and also with Deng Xiaoping, the architect of China's opening and reform. What I argue is that what happened in post-1978 years were precisely a revival of ideas that emerged during the specialization and coordination movement. Chinese economic actors came up with new terms such as horizontal economic relationships to describe the enterprise-level coordination they had discussed extensively back in the 1960s with much less circumspection. With the lifting of taboos about capitalist ideas, they started to talk openly about the market and the benefits of market coordination. What I have demonstrated in my thesis is that the seemingly radical market reforms in 1978 were direct outgrowth of the problems of coordination being explored in the 1960s during the specialization and coordination movement, and even back to the complete factory model during the Great Leap Forward. To put it differently, important aspects of the market reform of 1978 actually originated from the enterprise-level problem-solving process that I studied during the radical socialist period. I would like to thank my advisor, Professor Matsaka, as well as Professor Garrett and Professor Katana for the encouragement and edits and advice they have given me in this process. I want to thank my friends from the Intercollegiate Fellowship. Without them, my 4 years would have been very different. I want to thank my friend Simon, who has been with me during very difficult times of the thesis writing process. And I want to thank my parents and my grandfather, who has lived through many of the movements that I just described. He passed away in 2009, and I dedicate this thesis to him. Thank you.
Do you have a PowerPoint, Erica? All right, thank you, Zhongji, for this fascinating presentation. Next up, we'll be hearing from Arianna Regalado, class of 2018. The title of her paper is Nagasaki as City of Prayer, from the Jesuit Mission in 1549 to the Atomic Bomb in August 1945.
Thank you. Hello, my name is Arianna, and I will be presenting the research I have been doing through the sophomore early research program. About the influx of Christianity in Japan and the lack of success of implementing this new religion into the region. So my research is central to the exploration of the little-known roots of Christianity in Japan and the failure of Christianity to spread across the country. My investigation begins with the movement of Christianity into Asia and explores the geopolitical circumstances behind this failure by answering these pertinent questions. How did Jesuit missionaries led by St. Francis Xavier attempt to spread Christianity in this country? How did the geopolitical and historical context of the time detain the transfusion of culture and religion into the regions of Japan? How were the Japanese Christians treated by the rigid Tokugawa reign that hindered the spread of Christianity? What techniques and propaganda were used to spread Christianity, and how were they successful or not? While parts of Asia constitute some of the largest Christian congregations in the world, most notably the Yoido Full Gospel Church in South Korea, consisting of 830,000 members, Japan is little known for its Catholic devotion. Japan, however, has been the target of missionary movements, Christian propaganda, and Catholic church settlements since the 16th century, and has been the battleground for one of the most gruesome Christian persecutions in history. Through my presentation, I will explore the failure of Catholicism to flourish in Japan, beginning with the history of the Jesuit movement into Asia during the 16th century. I will also explore the violence en masse against the Japanese converts under the Tokugawa reign and the underlying reasons behind the persecution. After this important phase, my presentation will conclude with the evolution of Christianity in Japan through the eyes of the famous late 20th century novelist Endo, whose works Deep River and The Sea in Poison explore his cognitive dissonance of being both Catholic and Japanese, and the reasons behind the failure to spread Christianity in his native country as related to ancestral religions, persecution, and religious colonialism. So beginning with the history of early missionaries in Japan, Francis Xavier was the first Jesuit to travel to Japan under missionary pretenses in order to convert the Japanese people to Christianity. Europeans had already come to Japan. The Portuguese landed in 1543 in the island of Tanegashima, where they introduced the first firearms into Japan as an incentive for creating settlements within the region. He was sent by King John of Portugal to convert countries that needed Christian values. He reached Japan on July 27, 1549, with his translator Angito and three other Jesuits. At this point, the Japanese people were already Buddhist or Shinto and were not easily converted to Christianity. Xavier wrote to his friends in Europe, "I asked a Portuguese merchant who had been for many days in Angito's country of Japan to give me some information on that land and its people from what he had seen and heard. All the Portuguese merchants coming from Japan tell me that if I go there, I shall do great service for God, our Lord, more than with the pagans of India, for they are a very reasonable people." Xavier, unfortunately, lacked fluency in the Japanese language, and he preached by reading aloud the translation of a catechism. And he had brought his paintings of the Virgin Mary to display as he preached the catechism. There was an incredible language barrier, and the missionaries struggled to pick up the Japanese language. They described the Japanese language as something they've never seen before. Xavier tried very hard to persuade the Japanese that the Christian God was not evil, despite creating everything, including suffering and evil. May I remind you that they believed in Buddhism, which is the annihilation of all suffering, and the stop of samsara and the cycle of suffering. So in order to preach a God that created the suffering was a little counterintuitive to their philosophy. Hell was already hard to sell the Japanese on, as they did not like the concept of being in an eternal state of hell, especially with their ancestors in the burning flames. One of Xavier's obstacles when it came to converting the Japanese people was, of course, his translator, Anjiro. Anjiro was originally a murderer who confessed his sins to Xavier and was the first Japanese person to be converted and baptized, Pablo de Santa Fe. He then joined Xavier as his translator in order to help him spread Christianity in Japan. Paulo, unfortunately, was a very poor translator. Paulo translated the Christian God into Dainichi, and the Japanese word for Vairocana Buddha. So many Japanese people thought that Xavier was preaching about Buddhism and not the entirely different religion of Catholicism. So when Paulo realized his mistake, he started using the Latinized Dosu in place of Dainichi. Moreover, after the Buddhist monks realized Xavier was preaching a new religion, resentment towards him formed among them. So this also posed an obstacle for Xavier because of the amount of power Buddhist monks had in both popularity and outreach of the Japanese people. Another setback faced by Xavier was the political instability of the land. He went to Kyoto with the hopes of converting the Emperor of Japan, in hopes that the entire nation would follow suit, but he quickly saw that this would be futile because of the instability of the Sengoku period running between 1467 to 1603. The Sengoku period was characterized by constant war and instability, but later ended with the Tokugawa shogunate when they took over in 1603 and unified warring states. During the Sengoku period, Xavier and his Jesuit missionaries succeeded in converting Japanese to Christianity and became so popular it threatened the rule of the Tokugawa shogunate. Xavier was sent to Goa in 1552 and hoped to convert the Chinese also, but died in Shogutan Island off its coast in the same year. He felt he had been successful in Japan with a stay of 2 years because there were congregations established in Hirado, Yamaguchi, and Bongo. Tokugawa shogunate became very wary of the power of the Portuguese and the missionaries in Japan, so they decided to outlaw Christianity in Japan altogether in 1614, sentencing all of the missionaries that had come from Portugal back home or killed. This is when the persecution began. For example, in 1615, a Franciscan priest from New Spain asked the shogun for land to build a Spanish fortress and made the Japanese ruler suspicious against Catholicism and the colonial powers even stronger. The Japanese converts had to go into hiding when the Tokugawa declared war on Christianity in Japan. At the height of missionary activity, there were 130,000 converts from the Japanese people. Those who failed to hide their faith were tortured and killed in monstrous ways. For example, Unzen Jikogu, literally meaning hell, is a hot spring located an hour and a half from Nagasaki. That was used to boil alive 40,000 Christian Japanese converts during the Tokugawa reign as a form of torture and persecution in order to deter converts from joining the Christian suit. Hidden Japanese converts would travel to remote islands and live in caves to avoid being tortured and killed. There were often missionaries coming with them as priests, and they hid in caves with them. There was a notable story that I read during my research that had one of the priests living in the caves, and the priest was seen as a savior that would continue after the Tokugawa reign would be lifted. So he stayed in the cave and would never ever open the door. If they had fire running to cook a meal, They were afraid that boats on the shore would see this flame and tell the Tokugawa reign that someone was there. And in essence, they would be committing suicide. And when travelers came to the cave, they would barge in and ask for forgiveness from the priests, especially if they were Christian converts. If not, they would ask them, "I know you're there. I know you're there. Please come out. I come in peace. I am a Christian convert." In which the priest would either have to sacrifice himself in the hopes of him actually being a convert and telling the truth to them, or kind of go against his own tradition of Christian martyrdom and forsake this new convert. Most often than not, the priest would oblige to the convert and let him in. Hidden Japanese converts would travel to these remote islands. Most notable, Goto has since erected a statue of Christ in order to commemorate the Japanese converts who lived in caves on this remote island. A fumi was used to distinguish devout Christians once captured. A fumi was an image of Jesus or Mary that the Tokugawa shogunate of Japan required closeted Christians to step on in order to prove that they were not actually Christians. Those that did not step on the fumi were later banished from the actual Christians that were clandestine during this time, and were seen as outliers, that were seen as someone that would go against the Christian faith, and they were literally shunned from the Christians that actually did spit on the that did not spit on the fumi and kept to their ways, who were mostly killed. Now the Vatican is working with Japanese historians to look for Christian sites in Japan where converts fled in order to commemorate them as World Heritage Sites. So this work is still going on today, and this research is still predominated within the region, even if it is a minority. The edicts banning Christianity were still part of the law, and so Christianity continued to be persecuted up to 1867 when the Tokugawa shogunate reign came to an end. One of the reasons for Christianity's success was that church rituals and masses were performed by Japanese and gave the Japanese church a native face. Some of the problems that the Japanese encountered in their conversion was the fact that the missionaries brought in a certain breed of Christianity. It was a colonialist type of Christianity that they brought. They were from Portugal. They brought their Madonnas. They brought their Anglo-looking Christian figures. So the Japanese were having a really hard time praying to those that did not look like them, praying to an Anglo figure that did not resemble their facial features, and was essentially a certain type of colonialism, a certain type of religious colonialism, in which these people garnered power by using their objects as a force in which to gain more power and more territory amongst the people. And this is what actually brought the Tokugawa reign to a standstill and ordered all of them to leave, because they were worried that their power within the converts was growing much too rapidly for their taste. In the sense, once New Spain saw the success of the Portuguese in converting these Japanese people, they quickly wanted to create a fortress under the means of creating more Christian values within the region. So in a sense, this was kind of a subdued form of colonialism in which religion was used as a vehicle to create more power within the Iberian Peninsula once they conquered more of this land through the use of these religious symbols that were Anglo-based. So one of the reasons for Christianity's success was the implementation of more of a brotherhood within the Japanese themselves. So it was much easier to convert Japanese people once they converted Japanese brothers into the brotherhood. So they were able to become priests and in that sense convert their own within their own language. So there was not a barrier within the language because it was their people. One of the most notable forms of this was the many daimyos, or feudal lords, that were converted to Christianity in order to gain access to gunpowder. So gunpowder was also used as an incentive to gain the Japanese into Christianity, because they had access to gunpowder and the Japanese did not. So in order to kind of maintain their own power, the daimyos, which were feudal lords, kind of gain access into these new military vehicles by their transcendence into Christianity, whether legitimate or not. So in this sense, the Urakami Cathedral today is one of the most famous depictions of Christianity in Japan. It is a Roman Catholic church located in Nagasaki. Its construction began in 1895 after a long-standing ban against Christianity was lifted. The atomic bomb fell right onto it on August 9, 1945. There was an enormous loss of faith within the region of Nagasaki, considering Nagasaki was an epicenter of Christianity, and many of the converts lived there. And the replacement was built in 1959 after a heated debate between the government and the congregation. The city government suggested preserving the destroyed cathedral as a heritage site and offered an alternative site for a new church. But yet, many of the converts believed that this was their own, and they wanted to build right on top of it in order to reconstruct their faith within the region. They did not want to be dislocated. So in a sense, in Endo, as you see the book there, he was Catholic and both Catholic and Japanese. So there was a strong cognitive dissonance amongst the Japanese people in which he tried to portray God in his books through different forms in order to appeal to the modern Japanese society that have now kind of had, once the Christian ban was lifted, the modern society has kind of been ambivalent to the Christian domain. So in the sense that religion has, as a whole in modern society, has kind of shifted to the outskirts of contemporary youth. Endo used his literature in ways to frame God as a much more appealing source, as a woman, as a vulnerable figure, in which to kind of lure the Japanese contemporary youth into being more open to the new faith. But again, as you see now in contemporary Japan, this has not been successful. As when you think of Japan, you don't think of Christianity. But hopefully after this presentation, you will see that a period in Japan was actually very much devoted to Christians and their persecution. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Arianna. Another fascinating presentation. Next up, we'll hear from Zainab Younus. Zainab is an international relations economics major, graduating in 2017, and she'll be speaking to us today on the topic of Nehruvian India, the use of economic planning to rapidly industrialize an agricultural economy.
Hi, everyone. So today I'm going to be speaking about Nehruvian India, more specifically his use of economic planning to rapidly industrialize the agricultural economy. That was India's economy during post-independence time in 1947. So to begin, just a quick outline of today's talk. We're going to end with the question of, were Nehru's plans effective? Was the planned economy the means of trying to industrialize the Indian economy? So prior to colonization, India definitely had a manufacturing industry. They exported textiles and cotton to various countries. In fact, Britain was one of their largest importers. So we did see this economic relation between the two countries dating back to the early 1700s. However, upon colonization, by 1871, the British had went ahead and created this system in which now the Indians were no longer exporting their manufactured goods, but rather importing it from Britain and exporting raw materials that were going to be processed in England. So they created this dependent cycle on within India in which they no longer had a manufacturing industry. And as a result, you see somewhat of a demanufacturization, deurbanization, so to say. You have people moving away from cities and going to rural areas. Because of the lack of a manufactured goods industries, there is no more jobs for artisans. So as a result, you have no option but to go back to the rural areas and to now join the workforce in the agricultural sector. A great statistic that shows this is in 1800, you had 11.5% of the population in urban areas. 7 decades later, this has decreased down to 8.5% in the urban areas. So you have this dependency cycle that has led to a shift in migration within India from the urban areas to the rural area. So instead of industrializing, when you have Britain industrializing at this time, you have a deindustrialization period within India. So now you have a British imposed drain. And the Indian political scholar and leader, Nehruji, he called this the drain in the sense that you have significant wealth leaving from India and going to Britain. If we have a lot of economics professors here, you know that when you have wealth leaving the country, you're not going to be able to invest within the country. You cannot have economic development and growth. And so what you see is tax revenue, Indian tax revenue, being sent to England and covering administrative costs within England, not within India. Moreover, this punitive tax burden didn't leave any surplus to invest. Not only do you have income leaving the country, you don't have immigrants coming into the country to be employed and to create revenue in that sense either. So without savings, without investments, you cannot have economic growth. Under colonization, India's manufacturing industry has decreased, and so really you have them being dependent on the British for economic success. And then we have the Swadeshi movement, fast forward to 1905. This is really a movement in which they're trying to break away from this dependency cycle. It's a nationalist movement, and that is really an anti-colonial movement. So there is significance of cloth to India's history and story. Really, you have the reasons why the British first came to India is really truly the high quality Indian cotton and the silks. And in England, you had them purchasing Indian cloths, and then in 1870s, you had them now selling cloths to India. And that is a significant sense. And then because of that and understanding that, you have a lot of the Indian population stand up against this British dependency cycle and really protest and burning British cloth and creating this now made in India movement to really purchase Indian cloth and to help invest within the Indian economy in that sense. So it is a nationalist movement breaking away from, moving towards self-sufficiency and really breaking away from England. And the Swadeshi movement really is somewhat of an example of the outward approach that we have in the Indian political economy. A great scholar and economist, Ranade, he said that in order to build the Indian economy, in order to compete within the global markets, you need to build the Indian economy. And the Swadeshi movement really was an example of this, trying to build their own Indian cloths industry once again in the cotton industry. So now we're moving on to Nehru's influences, and I briefly touched upon Ranade. So going further into him, his theories in regards to the Indian political economy was really advocating for the state to play a larger role within the economic development process. Given the fact that you have a different nature to the Indian economy when you compare it to the classical liberal economy that we may learn in our economics courses. So within this system, the basic unit is not necessarily the rational individual. Rather, the basic unit is the family, the caste. And so as a result, the markets are regulated by customs. So in order to really develop the economy, Ranade said that the state needs to really play a larger force. Moving on to economic obstacles that we see in 1944, G.D. Birla, he's part of the Birla family, and the Birla family have a great significance and history in the industrial history of India. And so he's a businessman who noted to Parliament in a report three problems that he found within the economic system a few years prior to independence. And I have to say that these three, I think, were very much relevant to India at the time. The first is you have a lack of capital goods industries. There were consumer goods industries present, for example, rubber, cement, cotton, but you didn't really have these industries for steel, iron. Rather, these were being imported from England. And the reason why he calls for really investing in the capital goods industry is that investing in this industry rather than the consumer goods has a greater return in regards to the development process. In regards to employment specifically, you have a twofold effect that happens when you do invest in capital goods. For example, you have the primary employment, which is you're employing these people who are now going to work in your iron factories, your steel factories. Now that you have a growing industrial class, you're going to have a secondary employment as well, which is that now that you have this growing industrial class, you're going to demand more consumer goods. How are you going to meet the demand for these consumer goods? You're going to increase the supply, and thus you're going to have employment in the consumer goods as well. So for that reason, he really called on the state to really invest in capital goods. The second is that the manufacturing process wasn't completed domestically. As I had stated, you had raw materials leaving India, going towards England, and then the process of completing these goods and really building these goods happened in England. what does that mean for India? It's detrimental in the sense that they're losing out on the profits that could be made during this process. The fact that they're losing out on this profits means that they cannot invest it within their own economy. Rather, it's going towards helping the British economy and not necessarily the Indian economy. And then the last thing is we have a foreign control of the economy and thus economic policies. You have foreign capital and management significantly in industries like the oil industry, the mining, the shipping. And because of that, they're involved in the production process. One of the reasons why this is a problem is, for example, take the railway industry at this time. You had a lot of British nationals being employed, not necessarily Indian nationals. If you're not employing local laborers and rather importing labor from Britain, you're not providing a chance for the domestic population to really earn any income that can be invested in the Indian economy, because when you earn income, you're going to go spend it on goods. Rather, by employing non-nationals, you're leading to money again leaving outside of the country, which is a significant problem in India. So now we're going to move on to Nehruvian economics. So Nehru was the first prime minister of India after independence and partition in 1947. And he was greatly influenced by Ranade as well as the Soviets. So the Soviet model at this time was really state-led economic policies. And so seeing that both Ranade called for the state playing a larger role and looking towards the Soviet model in which the state did play a large role, Nehru went ahead and created the Planning Commission, who was tasked with the process of steering economic development within India. And this came out of the directive principles in the Constitution. And so we see that the Planning Commission really recommended not only planned economy, but also a series of five-year plans that were instituted. And the goals of this five-year plans were twofold. The first is to make the industrial sector the primary sector, as opposed to the agricultural sector, which we do see at the time is that you have the agricultural sector really being the prominent one. And then the second is that within the industrial sector, you would have the state, the public sector leading the efforts. It would not be the private companies and corporations and individuals, but rather the state. So a few of you might be asking, well, why? What is the focus on industry? Why such a heavy focus on industry? And the fact of the matter is that there are higher returns to industrial sector rather than agricultural. As well, you have this great statistic here is that at this time, you had 60% of the workforce in the agricultural sector, and that contributed to 75% of the GDP. You had 75% of the workforce in agriculture, and that contributed to 60% of the GDP. And that is a significant contribution. However, when you compare it to the statistic of the industrial sector, you only have 12% within this sector, and the contribution that they make is 25%. That's a quarter of the GDP. So Nehru really saw that there's a higher returns to the industrial sector, and thus you should really focus on capital-intensive projects because of the higher economies of scale. As well, if you can recall the twofold economic results, the employment results that happen are another reason why you should invest in industry and not so much the agriculture. So we have this creation of steel and power industries within India. So Nehru really was invested in both steel and the dams as well to provide power for these new capital goods industries. And so the Bhilai steel plant is a really great example of how not only a technological success as well as scientific success, but the fact that of the matter is during this time period, Nehru went ahead and signed agreements with different countries, three agreements to create steel power plants, one of which was with Russia. And the Russian and the Indian governments really came together and really worked together on this steel power plant. As I had stated in the beginning of my presentation, the railways was primarily dominated by the British. Unlike that, the steel plant was made by both the Indians and the Russian labor force. So the fact that you are including and employing Indian laborers is not only beneficial for the economy, but also leads to a greater economic development results. The second is dams. Nehru really viewed dams as the temples of modern India. He saw the success it had in developed countries, as well as in countries like the Soviets who were trying to lead development efforts. And so he was not only encouraged by this, but he saw it as a means to provide electricity to the growing capital goods industries that he was now trying to implement, as well as to control flooding and provide water for irrigation. So there are significant benefits that he saw to dams and went ahead. And we had the first one, the Bakra Nangal project, in which all men and women that were employed were all Indian. So again, you have this shift towards employing primarily Indian laborers, and that was open in 1954. the dams, were they a blessing or a curse? I think, honestly, there is a mixture. However, I would say that those who suffered the most were the low-caste peasants and the aboriginals who lived in the areas. A lot of people were forced to leave their homes, and that's a significant mental and emotional toll. Those who stayed, they were left to be, their lands were flooded as a result of the state going ahead with instituting the dams. And the second is really making the agricultural sector the breadbasket. And this is rather interesting because you have a majority of the population in the agricultural sector. So they're going to be playing now this secondary role in helping the industrial sector. During the partition time and the independence movement in 1947, you had the agricultural sector hit severely by this, and the food productions were rather low. What the five-year plans that Nehru instituted along with the Planning Commission is that they work to really bring the food production levels higher, and one way, so that way they can support the growing industrial class. So the purpose of the agricultural sector was really to play a supportive role to that of the industrial sector. And the last part of his plans was primarily the institutional reforms, the abolition of the zamindaris. The zamindaris, as Nehru saw, was a semi-feudal system. They were really seen by Nehru as an obstacle to agricultural and industrial production. What are the zamindari? Who are they? They are basically wealthy landlords who rented out lands to lower caste people and peasantry, for example. So in an effort to institute institutional land reform, the parliament went ahead and passed an act after much debate in 1951 that abolished zamindaris. It was not really affected. It only impacted 390 zamindaris, and those were those who were the largest zamindaris. Nehru did not necessarily see any problems with the zamindaris. He saw them as that there are a few large grand landlords and then multiple small ones who are not as wealthy. And in an effort to really, because they made up the electoral force, in an effort to really keep their popularity with these people and get their votes, this law did not really do much institutional reform. It didn't really do any land redistribution. So it wasn't successful in that sense. And so we now arrive at our final question, which is, were Nehru's plans effective? Again, there's going to be two sides to the story. I think that yes, it was in the sense that it did develop some level of manufacturing. So in that sense, it did accomplish that goal. Was this planned economy necessary at this time? I do think yes. I think Nehru really realized that the only way to really rapidly industrialize and get up on par, given their colonial history, is really to do the planned economy. In the no side, I think where it failed was its implementation of his plans. I don't think it went far enough, nor did it go deep enough, in the sense that it was very superficial on the surface, and the zamindari, the land reform, that is a significant example of how it failed to make institutional reforms. Moreover, creating new industries like they were doing from scratch, essentially, does cost money. If we can recall, India did not really have many savings. So as a result, you don't have much to invest from the beginning. So what you're investing are the profits that you make from these newly implemented industries. The issue is you're not leaving some to save and reinvest in the economy in the future. So you're making profits, but reinvesting it right away to make the payments of your costs. So in that sense, I don't think his plans were effective. I think it failed in the implementation, but was a planned economy the means to go about rapidly industrializing post-independence in 1947? I think ultimately yes, and that's what I discussed in my paper. And thank you guys so much for listening. I hope you enjoyed this talk. I don't know how to do this. Okay, sorry.
Thank you very much, Zainab. Interesting resonances with the first paper, and as we'll see, I think also with the final paper. So I'm pleased to present the last paper of the panel, which I also had the good fortune of being the advisor for, Pelumi Botti, International Relations History major. The title of her paper and her thesis is Decolonizing the African City, Realizing Visions of an Authentically Postcolonial African City.
So, morning. I'd like to begin with a short story from last year, actually. So, on the 9th of March, 2015, a University of Cape Town student, Chumani Matwele, smeared human feces on a statue of Cecil John Rhodes. Cecil John Rhodes was a colonialist, a famous British colonialist, and diamond magnate. This act sparked a national movement dubbed the Rhodes Misfall. Makwele and other UCT students, faculty, and staff demanded the removal of statues and what they called the decolonization of the university. Participants in the Roads Must Fall movement called for the university space to be rid not only of statues and plaques that commemorated colonial oppressors, but also legacies of colonialism, namely white supremacy, institutional racism, and economic inequality. This movement eventually spread to different parts of the country, different universities, and most notably to Rhodes' alma mater, Oxford University. So this just shows a few pictures of the movement. What is most notable, as you can see at the top right, is participants of the movement in UCT, the University of Cape Town, actually erected a shack, an informal settlement, as a way of claiming their space, the space as their own. So shacks are commonly inhabited by a lot of Black South Africans. So they built the shack. On 9th of April 2015, the statue was eventually removed from the campus grounds. But what is very important about this story is that the Rhodes Must Fall movement contributes to a long history of African attempts to decolonize public spaces. Just as members of Rhodes Must Fall protested to purge universities of colonial legacies, in the 20th century, colonized Africans, as well as post-colonial African leaders, made efforts to rid cities of problems associated with imperialism. And that was the focus of my thesis. I sought to answer the following questions. Firstly, what effects did colonial policies have on African urban dwellers? What actions did Africans take to resist oppressive imperial forces within the city? And how did African leaders and urban planners address the challenges inherited from colonialism? Finally, how effective have these anti-colonial actions been? In the interest of time, I will not be able to go in depth into a lot of these examples, but I will look at the following case studies, which are colonial Nairobi, a city in Kenya, East Africa, and the post-colonial cities of Dodoma and Abuja, which are found in Tanzania and Nigeria, respectively. So this is an image of colonial Nairobi. Colonial Nairobi was actually intended by the British colonialists as a city for only white inhabitants, with the exception of a few Indians. So if you can see from this sort of map how the city was divided, the bulk of the city was allocated to white Europeans. And there's a small section, which is Parklands, which was allocated to the Asians found were mainly Indians, indentured workers that were brought in by the British. And you see the black spots were actually for the African, colonized Africans and of Kenya. So as you can tell, the colonial administration made little consideration for the colonized Africans in the city. Social services and even housing were rarely provided for the black population of the city. In a 1942 report on housing in Nairobi, a colonial officer admitted that housing was not even considered for Africans in the initial plan for Nairobi. Housing for Africans was mainly provided by the private sector. The private sector provided limited, expensive, and poor quality housing to the African population. In a 1943 report, a government inspector described the housing available to Africans as appalling subhuman dwellings. In a city that ignored their presence, Africans carved their own spaces by establishing slums on the periphery of Nairobi. These informal settlements, with no municipal control, were constructed by the African population as sources of housing. With no control over them, these informal settlements pose a threat to the colonial authority. Colonial officers consequently were deeply suspicious of these slums and deemed them as breeding grounds of discontent and future troubles. Despite several attempts by the municipal government to destroy the slums, they still remained. Unable to stop the rise of slums, in 1919, the municipal government identified Pumwani District as the first African housing scheme. Thus, Africans were legally allowed to build their houses in the Pumwani District, which was later followed by other African housing schemes. Africans in the city also actively resisted colonial authorities by mobilizing in labor strikes, seeking improved living conditions and rights as Nairobi residents. In 1939, the housing crisis reached a crescendo as Africans mobilized in labor strikes over the high cost of rents and their poor living conditions. In fear of another African uprising, the British colonial government made efforts to respond to the housing crisis. The Nairobi Municipal Authorities constructed housing to accommodate African casual labor. However, it's important to note that most of the housing that was actually provided were barrack or dormitory style housing, which was ill conducive for family settings. It mainly suited single male workers. From this example of Nairobi, you can see that although disenfranchised, colonialized Africans mobilize against racist urban policies and claim their space in the city. The construction of informal settlements and shanty towns served as grassroots efforts to defy colonial urban policies and decolonize the city. By creating these informal settlements, Africans redefined spaces in the colonial city as their own and provided their own means for survival in the absence of provisions from colonial governments. I will then move on to post-colonial mechanisms. And in my research on decolonizing this African city, I came across various methods used by post-colonial leaders to rid the city of imperial legacies. Certain African leaders chose to rename former colonial cities with Afrocentric and vernacular names. For example, in 1966, Mobutu Sese Seko of the Democratic Republic of Congo renamed Leopoldville, which is named after the Belgian king, King Leopold, to Kinshasa. Similarly, Salisbury of present-day Zimbabwe was renamed Harare in 1982. Similar to the Rhodes Must Fall movement, monuments erected to celebrate colonial oppressors were removed from cities and replaced with monuments dedicated to African freedom fighters or emblems of national unity. In a further step, several post-colonial African leaders, overwhelmed with the deficiencies of the city, which they highlighted as overcrowding, inequality, chose to abandon former colonial capitals and create new national capitals altogether. That was my thesis primarily focused on the relocation of African national capitals as a means of decolonizing the urban space. I studied the capitals of Tanzania and Nigeria, Dodoma and Abuja, as case studies of the two relocated planned cities. Both countries were formerly colonized by the British, with one country being located on the east of the continent and the other located on the west. The post-colonial political regimes of both countries differed greatly. In 1973, the Tanzanian government announced the capital would be transferred from Dar es Salaam to Dodoma. Efforts to transfer the Nigerian capital from Lagos to Abuja began around the same time in 1976. However, with political instability and multiple coups, the capital of Nigeria was only officially transferred from Lagos to Abuja in 1991. So here is just a picture of Dodoma at the top and Abuja is at the bottom. So I'm going to give a quick comparison between the two cities. So the design of Dodoma was heavily influenced by the Arusha Declaration, which was a 1967 state address given by the Tanzanian President Julius Nyerere. So he is here pictured. In the Arusha Declaration, Nyerere outlined the country's commitment to becoming a socialist state. Nyerere intended for Dodoma to be a classless city, the antithesis of the former capital, Dar es Salaam. The major themes of the Arusha Declaration were such as self-reliance and agriculture were used as pointers in the plan for Dodoma. Recognizing his country's poverty in the 1970s, and as well in the theme of self-reliance, Nyerere insisted that the new capital of his country would be built with minimum costs and built within the country's means. As such, buildings were limited to a maximum of 4 stories and restricted from having costly features such as air conditioning and elevators. Nyerere did not want investments in the capital city to come at the expense of the development of the rural areas. Thus, Dodoma was designed as a low-cost city that would complement and not overshadow the rural areas. His economic plans focused on socialism and developing the rural areas influenced his reluctance to develop a grandiose capital city. In a bid to limit private property ownership, Dodoma's circulation plan actually de-emphasized the use of cars in the center of the city, but instead featured bus lanes, bicycle lanes, and pedestrian paths. So here's a graph of a picture of the plan, and it mainly features pedestrian and busways, which he felt would foster, in his theme of community and social relations, he felt that you would interact better when you're in a bus or interact better with bicycles than private car ownership and things like that, which he linked to capitalism. At the time of the decision to transfer the Nigerian capital, on the other hand, the federal government of Nigeria had a completely different political ideology and consequently different aim for the capital city. Firstly, unlike their Tanzanian counterparts, in the 1970s, Nigeria enjoyed immense wealth from a recent oil boom. The federal government of Nigeria thus sought to establish a new capital that would rival other global capitals, quite unlike the plans of Nyerere. More importantly, having recently emerged from a painful civil war, the government sought to establish a new capital that was ethnically neutral and would promote a strong national identity. The government attributed the ethnic tensions that plagued the country to divisive politics carried out by the former colonial power. As such, a conscious decision was made to locate the capital in a region of the country that was not dominated by either of the country's major ethnic groups. The former capital of Lagos is actually located in a region dominated by the Yorubas, one of the country's major ethnic groups. So Abuja was located in the center of the country in a region inhabited by minority ethnic groups. So this map just shows you the position of Abuja, which is quite in the middle, it's just right in the middle of the country. The Tanzanian post-colonial government also decided to relocate the capital from the coast to the center of the colony. Of the country. And like the case of Abuja, the transfer of the Tanzanian capital to the central region was not in a bid to mitigate ethnic tensions. Rather, the Tanzanian post-colonial government argued that the transfer was in a bid to oversee the country's economic development, which Nyerere believed would only come through agricultural production. Nyerere's government pursued a policy of African socialism entitled Ujamaa, which is translated from Swahili to mean brotherhood or family, familyness, I guess, which saw the formation of collective farms in a policy of rural and agricultural development. By relocating the capital to Dodoma, which was located in the rural heartland, the government intended to monitor the implementation of the Ujamaa program. The successes of Abuja and Dodoma are however questionable. Abuja was intended to be a city free of the colonial legacies of ethnic and religious rivalry, socioeconomic inequality, and segregation. The city was thus hoped to unite Nigeria's diverse ethnic and religious groups, promote a strong identity, and be accessible to all Nigerian citizens. Ultimately, Nigeria was designed to avoid the pitfalls of Lagos, the former colonial capital. The different political ideologies, corruption, and greed of several Nigerian leaders stood in the way of the Abuja master plan being fulfilled. So unlike Tanzania, Nigeria's political history has been a turbulent one with many coups and changes in power. So at the time of the decision to transfer the capital to Abuja, which was in 1976, up till the official time that the capital was in 1991 was finally officiated, Nigeria had about six different leaders as a result of different coups. Each leader, particularly the military dictators of the 1990s, who are at the bottom, which is General Babangida and Sani Abacha, each of these leaders made significant changes to the Abuja plan. All of them adopted, both of them were both Hausa and both Muslim, and they each changed the plan to suit the architectural traditions of their own whether ethnicity or religion. So the cityscape of Abuja is now dominated by Northern and Islamic architectural features at the exclusion of other cultures. Quite contrary to the initial vision, Abuja is now a city of great inequality, both culturally and socioeconomically. Moreover, the city is unaffordable and consequently inaccessible to most members of the Nigerian middle and lower classes. The dominance of one ethnicity on the city's landscape and the prevalence of socioeconomic inequalities were all issues prevalent in the colonial city. In the case of Abuja, the planned post-colonial city innovatively recreated some of these very challenges. To rid the Tanzanian urban space of colonial legacy, the Nyerere government envisioned a brand new city that complemented rural collective farms, was self-sufficient, and embodied African socialism. These are characteristics Nyerere socialist government disassociated with the colonial influenced city of Dar es Salaam. Realizing this new African socialist city of Dodoma was a different story. The reliance on the West for urban planners and financial aid, however, complicated this vision of Tanzanian self-reliance and African socialism. Dodoma is perhaps more economically accessible to its citizens than Abuja. However, the capital is often described as a ghost town that is only active at certain times of the year, mainly when parliament is in session. After that, members of parliament fly back to their homes in Dar es Salaam. Many government buildings still remain in Dar es Salaam. So, thank you.
Thank you very much, Pelumi. So we do have about 4 minutes left for questions for these incredibly stimulating and well-researched papers. So perhaps someone from the student population would like to ask a question? If not, I'm going to turn to the professors and other attendees. Any questions from the crowd? Please.
I'm just curious as to what the native Japanese didn't like about the native religions that made them think that Christianity was better.
From my research and the stories that I, because it was a lot of stories based, I think that not so much their dislike of the religions that they had, which was Buddhism and Shintoism, so much so as the incentives and the consistent pressures that were placed by the Jesuits that were there. So it was not so much a dislike of the current religion, so much so as the incentives, both economic and military, of the Christians. So the Christians did offer gunpowder, so that was a military incentive for the daimyos. So feudal lords were now able to convert to Christianity, have access to this economic power, because of course that these Jesuit religions were an extension of the Iberian Peninsula and of an entire Portuguese economic power, because they were derived from Portugal. So in a sense, you are now gaining access to the Portuguese's economic and military powers, and that's a huge incentive. So it wasn't so much their dislike of Buddhism as much as it was, ooh, what can I get after I convert to Christianity?
So did they really actually convert, or did they fake it?
That's really up to like an individual perspective. I am no position to really decide whether someone is really of complete faith or not. My advisor was Professor Kadera, and we had extensive dialogues of the way that hidden Christians were actually also sometimes illegitimized at the point in time in which they were pressured. So when they had to spit on images of the Christian Mary, images of the Virgin, they couldn't, because they knew that they were going to be killed right after if they spit on. They were either going to be killed if they didn't spit on it, or they were going to be shunned entirely and banished from their own native communities because they were not committed to the faith. So in the sense that they were either going to be shunned or they were going to be killed. So in a sense, there were pressures to be either legitimized or illegitimized. So that's really an individual commitment that I am not positioned to claim whether someone is a fake Christian or someone's a real Christian. That's really up to someone's individual selfhood and their commitment to the religion as a whole.
I'm afraid I think we do have to finish up because it's 10:40. Sadly, we could talk for another half hour, another hour. So I think we'll just have to give one more hand of applause to the speakers for today.